It's an old story, but it always makes me smile when I hear it. It's the story of a monk, a monastery, and a vow of silence. Now, as the story's told, every 10 years, a monk in a certain monastery was allowed to break his vow of silence and speak two words. Well, 10 years go by, and it's the monk's first chance to speak his two words. He thinks for a moment, and then he says, "Food, bad." 10 years later, the same monk is once again permitted to speak only two words. This time, he says, "Bed, hard." 10 more years pass by, and once again, it's the big day. He stares at the head monk, and he says, "I quit." And the head monk says, "Well, I'm not surprised. You've done nothing but complain ever since you got here." It's been my observation over the years that humanity has a constant complaint when it comes to God and how God is doing things. Now, unlike the monk, we don't need two words to vocalize our complaint. Our complaint can be summed up in one word: evil. The one thing that everyone struggles with is our experience of evil. Now, we've got lots of questions about evil. That's why we've dedicated 3 weeks of our time here at Broadway Church to investigating this challenging subject. Now, we began last week by answering a foundational question: where does evil come from? Who created evil? Now, after interacting with a couple of views representing some common misconceptions regarding the origin of evil, we then focused upon the biblical view. And we learned that, according to the biblical understanding, evil is not the presence of something, evil is the absence of something. Evil's not a thing that you hold in your hands or see with your eyes. Evil is not an object that had to be formed or fashioned or created by someone. Evil's not the presence of something, it's the absence of something. Just like darkness is the absence of light, like cold is the absence of heat, evil is the absence of good. Okay, but if evil is the absence of good, what exactly is good? I mean, if evil is the absence of good, what does the word good even mean? One of the byproducts of the French Revolution was the creation of the metric system, a system of measurement with the meter as the foundation of everything. For the metric system to work, there had to be an agreed-upon meaning of what was meant by the word meter. They had to answer the question, precisely, exactly, how long is a meter? Well, in 1799, a metallic bar made of platinum was housed in the National Archives in Paris. For many years, that platinum bar was the answer to the question, what's meant by the word meter? If you wanted to see if the meter being used in your town or your village truly was a meter in length, you could take your town's meter to the National Archives. You could hold it up against the actual meter to see how your meter compared with the actual meter. Well, that's how they answered the what is meant by the word meter question. Well, when we say evil is the absence of good, what do we mean by the word good? Well, we answer that question this way: good is the nature of God. What the platinum bar was to the concept of a meter, God's nature is to the concept of good. Good is a word that describes what God is like. We learned last week, God is the greatest conceivable being. He is perfection in every form, meaning moral perfection as well. That's why something can only be called good insofar as it measures up to the nature of God, because God is good. God is goodness. So, just like darkness is the absence of light and cold is the absence of heat, evil is the absence of good, and good is the nature of God. So, we learned last week a valuable principle. Here it is. The further we move away from God's nature, the more evil we experience. The further we move away from God's nature, the more evil we'll experience. Just like the further you move away from light, the more darkness you experience. The further you move away from heat, the more cold you experience. The further you move away from God's nature, His goodness, the more evil you experience. Because evil is the absence of good, and good is the nature of God. So evil is what we experience when we choose to reject or ignore or turn our backs upon or walk away from the goodness of God. Now, in my best moments, I don't want to do that. I mean, when I'm in my right mind, walking away from the goodness of God is the last thing that I want to do. But if I'm honest, I have to admit that there are moments in my life when I am tempted to do that very thing. If I'm honest, I have to admit that there are times in my life when I find myself actually doing that very thing, rejecting, ignoring, turning my back upon, walking away from the goodness of God. It's the insanity of sin. And it's a consequence of my past history of rebellion against God. Think in these terms. Many years ago, back when I was in college, I was driving my car on a winter day. The road was icy, covered in snow, and I was going too fast. I was breaking the speed limit, actually, and I tried to turn the corner, but instead of turning the corner, my car slid on the ice and crashed up against the curb, bending just a bit the wheel of my vehicle. And as a result of that moment of foolishness, as a consequence of my rebellion against the traffic laws on that day, from that moment onward, my car constantly pulled to the left. If I wanted to keep moving straight ahead, I had to constantly fight against the inner pull of my damaged vehicle. I had to constantly resist the pull of my warped wheel. Well, in a similar way, you and I have been damaged by sin. Now, don't get me wrong. As followers of Jesus, we have been forgiven of our sin. However, the damage that was done by our rebellion is still being felt in numerous ways and to varying degrees in our lives. And to this very day, in order to keep steering straight in life, we have to consistently and constantly fight against the inner pull of our damaged humanity. It's what one New Testament writer referred to as the sinful nature. He described the dynamic of knowing what's right in our minds, yet often desiring what is evil in our hearts. He described it this way. He said, "I myself in my mind am a slave to God's law, but in my sinful nature, I'm a slave to the law of sin." He's saying, listen, I know what's right in my brain, but in my experience, I often do what I don't want to do. So is there a way out of this trap? Is there a way to live above the sinful nature? Is there anything we can do to keep steering straight in our lives? Is there a way to resist the pull of sin in our lives? Well, last week, we did our best to answer the question, what is the origin of evil? Today, we're seeking to answer the question, so how can I resist evil? Now, the answer to last week's question was a little tricky. It was a bit complicated. The answer to this week's question is quite the opposite. It's actually incredibly simple. How can we resist evil? Well, if evil is the absence of good, and good is the nature of God, and if the further we move away from God's nature, the more evil we experience, then it only stands to reason that we resist evil by clinging to the presence of God. We resist evil by clinging to the presence of God. Think in these terms. The human condition, it's universal. Our sin, our rebellion, our walking away from God has actually caused us to experience eternal separation from God. Meaning, sin in our lives has separated us from a holy God. A holy God cannot dwell with sin, just like a healthy body can't dwell with poison. A healthy body rejects poison. A holy God rejects sin. Our problem is we have become contaminated by sin, so we have eternally separated ourselves from God, and there's nothing we in ourselves can do to bridge that gap, to get back into the presence of God. And that's why Jesus came. Jesus is God in flesh, and he did what we could not do. He lived a perfect, sinless life. He came to earth and he offered his sinless life in exchange for our sinful lives. If you can think in these terms, he was like a sponge for sin. And as he hung on the cross, he absorbed all of the sin of the world upon himself. But because he himself was sinless, sin had no ultimate hold over him. And Jesus rose from the dead, defeating the power of sin, defeating the power of death. And then he offers the gift of forgiveness and eternal life to everyone who will accept that gift. And then here's another key. To everyone who accepts the gift of forgiveness and eternal life, God then comes and dwells within them by his Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit lives within us, dwelling within us and empowering us to live new lives, to live lives within his presence, lives interacting with him. I mean, that's what the scripture writer meant when he said, "Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you've received from God?" A temple is a place, of course, where God dwells. And the scripture writer was saying, "Don't you know you're God's temple now? God dwells within you." So the further we move away from God's nature, the more evil we experience. So we resist evil by clinging to the presence of God. James, the brother of Jesus, put it this way: "Submit yourselves then to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Come near to God, and he will come near to you." James' advice gives us an opportunity, actually, to touch on a common misconception when it comes to evil. And that misconception has to do with the role of the devil when it comes to evil. Here's the key: the devil is not the source of evil. The devil merely traffics in evil. I'm going to say that again. The devil is not the source of evil. The devil merely traffics in evil, like a drug dealer traffics in drugs. That drug dealer probably didn't create those drugs. That drug dealer is not the source of those drugs, but that drug dealer traffics in those drugs. Well, the devil is a creature that, with full awareness of what he was doing, chose to turn his back on God, to run as far away from God's goodness as possible, and then to devote himself to the destruction of everything God is seeking to do. And as a result, the devil is a creature that actively seeks to lie, lure, entice, and destroy as many human beings as he possibly can. So James tells his readers to ignore the devil's voice and follow God's voice. Submit yourselves to God. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Come near to God and he'll come near to you. So the focus of James' advice is not the power of the devil. The focus of James' advice is the presence of God. Come near to God is the big idea, if you will, of that verse from James. But practically speaking, what exactly does it mean to come near to God? I mean, practically speaking, how can a person come near to someone who's not physically present? How do you cling to the presence of something or someone that you can't see or touch? In the 1600s, a monk known as Brother Lawrence determined to do all that he could to live with an intentional awareness of the reality of the presence of the indwelling Spirit of God. Brother Lawrence determined to make it his goal in life to see every action he undertook as an intentional act of love towards the God who dwelled within him. So from the tiniest action of picking up a piece of straw to the loftiest action of seeking to preach the word of God, Brother Lawrence sought to do everything with the awareness of God's presence. And while doing this, he determined to do all that he could to maintain an ongoing conversation with God. His writings were later compiled under the title, The Practice of the Presence of God. So then, when we say cling to the presence of God, what do we mean? Clinging to the presence of God means practicing the presence of God. It means living your life with an awareness of and interaction with God's indwelling presence. Many years ago, when I was a youth pastor, I would often have young people come to me, or even their parents come to me and say, "You know, hey, Pastor Darren, what music can I listen to? Or what movies can I go to?" Or I'd have parents saying to me, "Pastor Darren, I want you to tell my kids what they can and can't do. I want you to tell them what they can't listen to and tell them where they can't go. You're the pastor. Tell them these things." It's a lot of pressure on a pastor to be the moral guideline for everyone's life. It's not my role. It's the role of the indwelling Spirit of God. And so what I sought to do was equip these students and these parents, if you will, to practice the presence of God, to cling to the presence of God. And so what I would say is this, and I would still say this today. If you're wondering whether the music you're listening to or the movies that you're watching, let's say, are appropriate, simply do this. Ask yourself, could I put the headphones on Jesus and open up the lyrics to the song that I'm listening to? And could I have Jesus listen to that song and read those lyrics and never be embarrassed at all about what I'm forcing Jesus to hear and read? Could I buy Jesus a ticket, sit down with him at that theater, offer him some popcorn and say, hey, Jesus, let's watch this together, and never be ashamed, never be embarrassed about what I'm forcing Jesus to watch and endure? If I'm not embarrassed or ashamed about what I'm having Jesus listen to or see, then I am fine and free to listen to that music and watch that movie. It's called practicing the presence of God because, practically speaking, that's exactly what we're doing. If Christ lives in us by his Spirit, every song that I listen to, every film that I watch, I am forcing him to listen to and to watch with me. It's practicing the presence of God. So how can we resist evil? One practical way to resist evil in your life is by clinging to the presence of God. A second practical way that we can resist evil is by filling our minds with the truth. We read these words in the New Testament portion of our Bibles. It says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever's true, whatever's noble, whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Now, why is Paul, the first century leader who wrote those words, why is he so adamant about filling our minds with things that are true and noble and pure and right? It's because Paul recognized that every sin begins in the mind. Every sinful act began as a tainted thought. That's what Jesus was trying to communicate when he declared, I tell you that anyone who looks at a woman lustfully has already committed adultery with her in his heart. Jesus is saying that acting out adultery with our bodies begins by imagining adultery in our minds. Einstein put it this way, thoughts are actions in rehearsal. That's why the Apostle Paul told us to fill our minds with the truth and purity, because evil actions begin as evil thoughts. Therefore, one way to resist evil is to address it at the incubation stage. Evil feeds on lies, but there's no room for lies in a mind that's filled with truth. I learned this reality many years ago in the midst of one of the most challenging and confusing moments of my ministry. Now, due to the intensity of what I'm about to tell you, I hesitated about whether or not to share it, but in the end, I decided I'm going to risk it. So here it goes. Many years ago, I was interacting with an individual within the congregation that I was serving at that time, and she had shared with myself and a team of people in our congregation about some terrible, traumatic things she experienced as a young child. Terrible abuse, actual ritual abuse, abuse at the hands of some religious people who did some awful, sexual, torturing things to her as a little girl, to the point that she was really attacked in the demonic realm. Now, by the time I met this individual, she was a grown woman with children of her own and was actually a professional in the law enforcement area. And she had undergone some terrible things as a young child, and it was haunting her. It was had been triggered in her life by an experience she went through in her career. She came to us and said, listen, I have this demonic influence in my life that I can't seem to get rid of. She was a follower of Jesus, but she felt continually being attacked in the demonic realm. I was new to dealing with this at that time in my ministry, and so I went into it naively. And it took the next year for us to deal with her in the demonic realm that was so infesting her life. I could tell you stories that would make you scratch your head. But let me just say this, after many, many hours, many weeks, months of dealing with the demonic realm, speaking to the demonic realm, interacting with the demonic realm. Finally, one evening, after a four-hour session of deliverance with this woman, I'll never forget the moment when I was looking in her eyes and praying over her and interacting with the demonic realm, when I finally saw her set free. I'll never forget her looking at me completely differently, with tears running down her cheeks and saying, "Pastor Darren, they're gone, they're gone." And we as a team all celebrated and danced and jumped around that room. She was finally, after almost a year of deliverance ministry, finally completely set free. Or so I thought. A couple days later, one of our team members called me and said, "Pastor Darren, I just spoke with I'll just call her Susie. That wasn't her real name. I just spoke with Susie, and she told me that they're back." I said, "What do you mean they're back?" She said, "The spirits, the demons, they're back." I hung up the phone and went for a walk in the rain, depressed, delusioned, confused, frustrated. I remember thinking, are we being played here? Is this woman just doing this for attention? I remember thinking, what do I believe anymore? I thought the name of Jesus was powerful. How can these things be back? And as I was walking alone in the rain on that blistery, bleary day, I felt the Spirit of God speak to me. I'm walking along and I look down on the ground and I see a pine cone. And I felt the Spirit of God impress upon me, "Darren, bend down and pick up that pine cone." So I did. I reached down, picked up the pine cone. And I'm looking at it. And as I'm walking with this pine cone in my hand, again, I felt impressed. The Lord said to me, "Susie is that pine cone." I remember thinking, I'm losing my mind. Susie is this pine cone? What does that even mean? But God unpacked this whole insight as I'm walking along. He showed me that inside the husk of this pine cone, all these little areas here are little pieces of dirt and debris. He said, those husks, if you think in these terms, those are all lies in Susie's life. And the enemy hides in the lies. And by doing a deliverance, what you did was you did a power wash and you removed all of those spirits from inside all those little lies. But as long as Susie continues to have these lies, those spirits will come back and embed themselves in the lie. I never forgot that. I've never looked at a pine cone again the same way. What I needed to do was give Susie a truth encounter. More than a power encounter, she needed to be equipped with the truth and to rebuke and renounce lies so the enemy had no place to hide. You see, it was then that I saw the words of the Apostle Paul in a whole new light. When he wrote, "Therefore, put on the full armor of God, so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after having done everything, to stand. Now stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the good news of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests." See, the words jumped out at me. Truth, righteousness, peace, Word of God. Now, this passage is often cited in descriptions of power encounters with the demonic realm, and rightly so. But on that day, through a pine cone, God showed me that while power encounters are sometimes necessary in our battle against evil, the most effective long-term way to defeat and resist evil is a truth encounter. You resist evil by filling your mind with the truth. At Broadway Church, we have the grow principle. You do these four things and you're guaranteed to grow. Give of your time, talents, and treasures every day. Read, reflect, respond to the Word of God in the presence of God. Look for an opportunity to share your faith with someone and walk with someone every day in your life. It's that R that I'm focusing on right now. Read, reflect, respond to the Word of God in the presence of God in your life. I mean, that's what we have, the step journal. That's why we have it here at Broadway Church. It's one way to read, reflect, and respond and fill your mind with truth. Scripture each day, that's the S. T is, what is that scripture teaching to you? E, what are you experiencing in response to what that scripture is saying? And P, praying in response to what you're experiencing. It's filling your mind with truth. All right, let's conclude. Today, we've done our best to answer the question, how can we resist evil? Now, we promised you that today's answer would be incredibly simple, and it can be summed up in today's big idea. How can we resist evil? Do these two things. Practice the presence of God, interact with the Word of God. Practice the presence of God, interact with the Word of God. It's really that simple. Resisting evil doesn't require expensive courses or fancy incantations or elaborate strategies. Resisting evil is as simple as practicing the presence of God and interacting with the Word of God. If you will do those two things, I guarantee that you will not only be delivered from evil, but you'll also be able to continually resist evil in all of its forms. Let's pray together. Spirit of God, I thank you that you dwell within us as followers of Jesus. We cling to your presence right now. And we do that by filling our minds with the truth, with your word, with the knowledge of your presence, with the power of your presence, with the experience of your presence. Fill our minds so that we can discern the truth. We can walk in the truth. We can discern the truth from the lies. We can renounce lies and accept the truth and apply the truth to our lives. So Spirit of God, I pray right now for every person who's watching me. I pray for every follower of Jesus that's watching me right now, first of all, that you will empower them in a fresh way, that you'll enlighten them in a fresh way, that you'll give them a new hunger, a new desire for the truth, and a new awareness of your presence, that your kingdom will come and your will be done in their lives. Perhaps you're watching me right now and you're not yet a follower of Jesus. That means that the Spirit of God does not yet dwell within you because your sins have not yet been forgiven by God. He's offering to forgive them, but you've not yet accepted his gift of forgiveness and applied it to your life. If you'd like to take that step right now to accept the forgiveness of Jesus that he purchased for you and to welcome the Spirit of God into your life, pray this prayer with me right now. God, I acknowledge my need for forgiveness, my need for a Savior. I don't want to live in rebellion any longer. So I turn my back on my rebellion and I run back towards your presence, your goodness, your life, your purity. I accept your gift of forgiveness and eternal life. Now come and fill me with your Spirit. Begin to transform me from the inside out. Now I know I'm not going to be perfect and sinless from this moment on, but as I confess my sins, you'll forgive me and you'll empower me and transform me day by day by day, renewing me, changing my desires, my thoughts, my very lifestyle, moment by moment. And God, would you give me the courage to tell somebody about this decision even before my head hits the pillow tonight? By the authority of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Well, if you just prayed that prayer with me, congratulations. The best advice I can give you is to text the number on the screen. Now, we're not tricking you. You're not joining Broadway. You're not about to be placed on a mailing list or bombarded with spam texts. Not at all. We'll respond to you once, simply offering our services to you in any way that we can. Well, God bless you. Thank you for being with us on week two of our evil series. Next week, we conclude by asking the question, so how does this evil ultimately end? We're going to answer that question next week. God bless you. Thank you for being with us at Broadway Church today.